this is a distraction that we could live without. Right. Hi, so let's get started. I'm Vijay and I'm one of the co-maintainers of Gluster. So today I'll be talking about a SWOT analysis for Gluster. Before we start, how many of you have ever sat through a SWOT analysis? A few hands, and it would perhaps look a lot like this with spider charts and everything. I'm not going to do any of this, primarily for two reasons. I didn't want to bore you with a lot of analytical stuff right up front in the morning when most of us are fighting our jet lags. The second, more important reason, I'm not very skilled at doing spider charts. Right, so SWOT analysis stands for an analysis of strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. We'll be going in that order. So let's look at what are the strengths of Gluster as things stand in 2017. Gluster is very well positioned for hybrid cloud storage. We have increasing community momentum, which is good. Gluster's ecosystem integration is doing reasonably well. We'll be looking at a bit of that. And I think over a period of time, we've settled on use cases. At this point in time, we have good clarity on the use cases that Gluster can go after. And we'll be seeing a bit of that through this session. Coming to hybrid cloud storage, so a lot of enterprises are gravitating towards what we term as hybrid cloud. So you would have a private cloud presence on-prem, and you would also have a public cloud story. So this is a change in the way IT is being consumed in enterprises, where earlier it used to be largely an on-premise story. So that's changing, and I think Gluster is very well suited to adapt or latch on to this significant paradigm shift in enterprise IT, or in the way storage is consumed. The key reason is that Gluster's architecture is simple and flexible, so it makes it easier to run on all kinds of platforms, starting from physical machines to virtual machines to containers to even public clouds like Amazon Web Services, Google Compute, and the likes. So the key strength of Gluster is that you get a consistent storage stack across your private and public clouds. And this is a strength that we've been witnessing and we can continue to build on. Gluster also has capabilities for data replication across hybrid cloud, which makes it easier for things like cloud bursting, where you need to move your data on-premise to the cloud, to the public cloud, and stuff of that sort. So let's take a look at community momentum, which is one of our key strengths. A good way to assess community momentum is to look at the predictability of releases, the way releases are being churned out by a open source project. And I think we've been doing really well here. So if you look at it, we released 3.10 in February of 2017. I don't know if it's very visible to folks at the back of the, okay, that's cool. So 3.10 had brick multiplexing improvements for rebalanced time estimation and stuff, and a few other enhancements. In May of 2017, we released 3.11 with Halo replication in beta, metadata performance improvements, and rebalance performance improvements. In August of 2017, we released 3.12 with support for subdirectory exports with the Fuse protocol. GFID to path is now supported by default. So for those who have struggled with figuring out what a GFID maps to, it is going to be easier going forward. Right, so and we are scheduled to release 3.13 in November of 2017 with the support for IPv6 and discard support in EC, amongst other things. So overall, it's been a healthy release stream with about 4 releases happening this year. So kudos to all of you who have made it happen. The next big thing is Gluster 4.0. So tentatively scheduled for February 2018, we are going to see Gluster D2, some support for GeoFproxy, N plus one scaling, which is the ability to scale in increments of one node. And 4.1, if we continue the same release cadence, hopefully in May of 2018, we might see some form of Rio distribution, Jira application to public cloud or S3, and some performance improvements as ever. So overall, we have done a lot of releases this calendar year, and we have a lot coming up, so which makes it a very exciting time in Gluster. It's not just about releases when I refer to community momentum. We've also done various things which is aiding the cause of releases going out faster. We've had improved diversity in community code contributions, so we're seeing more external contributors sending out patches, which is a good sign for us. The community leadership has been broadened. We have always taken pride that our software is not or does not have a single point of failure, and we have tried to apply the same philosophy to community leadership. So we have more core maintainers who form the actual leadership for the community. So we are expecting that to operate like a technical council, and we are evolving more details. We've added more component maintainers and peers to increase the velocity of code reviews and patch acceptance. Maintainers in Git reflects the current status of who's doing what in the community. We've also added new ecosystem projects like Glusterblock, Tendril, and others, and Gluster S3. So these kind of showcase the ability of Gluster to be extended for, I wouldn't say other, but use cases that can be built upon top of core Gluster. So that's pretty cool and exciting. We've also added an experimental branch, which is a low barrier for innovation, so to keep the innovation pipeline chugging along. The other key strengths of Gluster as we look at it today is the ecosystem integration and the most evolved ecosystem integration, if I were to say, is with containers today. So we've seen a lot of momentum with Gluster, Kubernetes, and the container ecosystem in general. We've evolved projects like Gluster Kubernetes and Hecate, which are helping in bridging or bringing about this integration between Kube and Gluster. The other ecosystem that we are very significantly integrated is with Ovirt. So we've been able to get hyperconvergence for virtual machines with Ovirt, and this is how easy to set that up. So we call this six steps to Nirvana, but it might be not so easy to attain Nirvana in real life. I know. Thanks. Right. So it's just not just Kubernetes or containers and Ovirt that makes our ecosystem more broader and richer. We've integrated with NFS Ganesha, Samba, TCMU Runner, Swift, and a slew of other projects. All these are good because that helps us in getting adoption, getting more use cases. So the ecosystem state is generally healthy at this point in time. Because of all the reasons that I explained before, or of all the strengths that I explained before, I mean, that gives us use case clarity for Gluster at this point in time. Scale out NAS is what Gluster started with. So scale out NAS across the hybrid cloud is going to be a key dominant use case for Gluster. It will continue to be the case. Container native storage or storage for containers is going to be big. So that's a prediction I'm making for Gluster. And hyperconvergence for virtual machines. This is an area where we will also see traction. So these are going to be the key use cases for us and the key focus areas. So let's take a look at weaknesses. So I've listed four. I mean, there could be more. There are more, and these are the four that were on the top of my mind when I was thinking about weaknesses. So let's look at usability. Setting up Gluster is pretty easy, right? So installing Gluster, creating the first volume, probably most of us can get it going in less than 30 minutes. So that's the easy part. But once you get it up and running, day two operations are not so easy. So by day two operations, I refer to storage lifecycle operations like replacing a failed node, replacing a failed storage server, replacing failed bricks, decommissioning servers. So things of that sort are not very easy at this moment. We have had limited success with GUI-based management with OVERT. We are looking at Tendril and a few other things to address this, but it is a weakness at this point in time. Monitoring is really painful. For somebody to understand what's happening in Gluster, a lot of homegrown scripts are usually the answer. We have some recipes, but there is still no formal way to monitor operations or understand what's happening within Gluster. The next is about creating a dispersed volume. So dispersed volumes usually work on JBODs or disks without any form of RAID, which means you usually would have a lot many disks that need to be combined together to form a volume. So here I've tried to club 18 disks to form a 4+2 distributed dispersed volume. And the CLI looks like this. But if you would increase the number of disks, which would be the usual case in practice, you can imagine the CLI to be taking all this slide, right? So which means that this gives scope for errors, for human errors to creep in. So we need to get better at things like this from a usability perspective. And by the way, I'm just don't think that I'm finger pointing here. I mean, it's across the stack. I've just picked up two examples that I could think about. The second one is Gluster volume remove break commit. And the message that we pop up then is, removing bricks can result in data loss. Do you want to continue? Really? So any serious administrator who is having production data, I don't think anybody would say yes, right? So we need to take a look at why these things have evolved and whether we really need this at this point in time. So usability is a key area that we need to improve upon. Scale has been something that we've been working on, but at this point in time, we have some issues to scale beyond, say, hundreds of nodes. Firstly, on the management side, we replicate state everywhere, and that causes a bottleneck. That's being improved with Gluster D2. In terms of data operations, we know that directories are replicated everywhere, and that can cause a class of workloads to not work well at scale. And such operations would improve with Rio in the future. Monitoring, we have a problem, but monitoring at scale is a bigger problem. So we need to look at how we address monitoring at scale. So eventing is a good step in that direction, the infrastructure that we evolved a few releases back. We're also looking at integrating with projects like Prometheus. Hopefully that should provide answers for monitoring at scale. Debugging at scale, so anybody who has done debugging or try to collect and analyze data from a few handful of servers know what I'm talking about, right? So when you have hundreds of servers or even tens of servers and several clients, trying to understand why a problem occurred is really, really painful. So when our scale improves, debugging at scale is going to be even harder. So we need to evolve tooling to get better at that. The one way that can address scale is by having more automation. We need to get better here. So in terms of our automated test coverage with respect to features is not so significant. So Glasto needs definitely more attention. Glasto is the test framework that we use. I mentioned about supporting at scale, so we need more automation for debugging at scale, which means we need tools for analyzing logs, doing performance analysis of data collected from a bunch of nodes. Day two operations, again, we do not have very clear procedures, and neither are they automated. JDeploy is probably the Ansible-based installer is probably the tool that we should look at for standardizing some of these procedures. And lack of automation also means that our release testing is non-deterministic. So that is an area that we can improve upon. Managing information or discovering information continues to be a pain. Our documentation, despite a lot of efforts, is still not the very best. There is definitely scope for improvement. Our messaging in terms of what we are doing has been not so frequent, and it's not very structured either. So I keep hearing a lot of questions in the community about, hey, when did this feature come out? What's this feature about? So making that information discoverable is going to help. And feature to release mapping has also not been very clear, but the GitHub projects initiative kind of gives us a better way to address this problem. Let's look at opportunities that lie ahead of us. Containers is going to be really key for us. So you could look at containers as the next wave of virtualization. So a lot of companies, storage companies, benefited from the first wave of virtualization with virtual machines. And we can similarly benefit with this upcoming wave of virtualization with containers. There are hardware and other game changers like persistent memory, NVMe, etc., that we need to look into to take benefit of the improved capabilities in hardware. Since we are commodity software that runs on commodity hardware, we can leverage benefits that come about in commodity hardware. There are emerging technologies like blockchain, machine learning, IoT, Internet of Things, which can form their own markets in the future. So being able to integrate with these markets while they're taking shape would probably be useful. It's an opportunity for us. And the other key thing is we need to innovate to outperform proprietary storage. So just being on par or providing the same set of capabilities with respect to proprietary storage is not going to be adequate. I think we are innovative, we are different than proprietary storage, but making this factor or making this innovation or the capabilities of Gluster more significant and more diverse than incumbents would make it more appealing for newer class of users to adopt Gluster. Now let's look at threats. The public cloud continues to be a threat for Gluster. So if every workload that is running in data centers today migrates to public cloud, a lot of what gets consumed in the public cloud would be controlled by the public cloud providers. So that could be a threat for us. So we would be at the mercy of public cloud providers, right? So they could choose to use Gluster, or they could choose to use their homegrown solutions or something else. So vendor lock-in is possible with public cloud, and that could be a problem. We've had our tiffs with proprietary storage, and that will continue both on the legacy side, and off late, it does seem to have become a cool thing to write a scale-out storage system. I'm seeing a lot of new incumbents or new storage vendors trying to come out with their own scale-out storage systems. We understand that it's not easy, but that's not deterring people from doing that. So some of them will be threats in the future. If we don't innovate, that's not going to help us. So that's a lack of innovation is a threat. And while we innovate, if we give up on stability, that is also a threat. So having a good balance between innovation and stability is really key. So that takes me to the end of my session. In summary, if I look back, I think we are in a great position at this point in time. We have very well-defined use cases, emerging markets that we are playing well. So this should definitely help us as we roll into 2018. So 2018 is going to be a big year for Gluster with 4.0 happening. And possibly in this summit next year, we'll be talking about 5.0. So yes, we are trending in the right direction, and that should make all of us happy that we are at this juncture. So if you have any questions, I would be happy to take them. I don't know how I'm doing on time. Right on time? Okay. Yes, please. Right. Rick's question is, have you witnessed other weaknesses than the ones that I described? So if you have any, please go ahead and...
You're trying to throw rocks or stones or rocks.
Well, my favorite one, at the risk of beating a dead horse, is memory consumption, both memory leaks and genuine consumption.
Sure.
Yeah. I got one more. I mean, these are the nasty NAS heads, right, that consume the storage. So performance on metadata operations compared to other scale-out storage system is rather weak. With appropriate caching, we can mitigate, but it's not like fundamentally solved.
I just played the Samba guys.
Any other thoughts? Going once, twice. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so I think one is the technology threat, but the other thing we have to stress upon is more of a community. We have to grow the community, whatever. I mean, we are growing. You started the talk with that, but I think we should focus on expanding it to more organizations than Red Hat, Facebook, and I mean, we have very handful, I mean, Data Labs contributed, so very handful of the companies. If they are writing their own, I think we should rather ask with them what is it and like why can't it. I think we should grow the community better.
How many core maintainers are here? I mean, should you all stand up so that people see who you are, maintainers?
Yeah, the maintainers who have been listed as core, Jeff, Raghavendra. Yes, please. Okay. All right. Sounds good. Yeah. So for the course of next 2 days, let's continue to build on our strengths, identify more of our weaknesses, and figure out hopefully ways to resolve them. Let's keep an eye out for opportunities and threats. And I think that's if we can do that, I think we would have achieved a lot during the next 2 days. Thank you.